Welcome to the Peter Legg Podcast, where you're empowered to lead, inspire, and influence. Now, here's your host and mentor, best-selling author, internationally acclaimed speaker, and community leader, Dr. Peter Legg.
I'd like to share with you that I'm going to launch a free public speaking series. So if you want to be a better speaker, you want to become a more effective and persuasive speaker, I can help you. Sign up for the ABCs of Public Speaking Seminar. How do you do that? Go to my website, peterlegg.com. That's peterlegg.com for Public Speaking Seminar, and you too can be a great speaker. Today, it's my pleasure to interview Pauline Stevenson. She's the founder and president of Excel Career College. She is winner of the Women of the Year of 2020, Leader Award by BC Business. Pauline, good to have you here. Welcome to the broadcast.
Thank you very much, Peter. It's a pleasure to be here.
Tell us a little about how you came up with this idea and what your dreams going forward are.
Wonderful. Well, it was like many entrepreneurial stories, it was off the side of my desk, a side hustle, as you will, before it had its own legs and gained traction. At the time of starting in 1989, I was working at an accounting firm, and my role was to analyze clients' accounting systems and find the right computerized accounting program, implement it, customize it, and then train the staff. And if you remember back at that time, computers and businesses were just emerging. So this was part of the computerization of businesses, bringing it into what we know today as a very digital world. There weren't many people doing what I was doing at that time. So I was very, very busy and booked up. And my clients asked me for more time. So they wanted night classes. So that's how the side hustle started. It was very much geared towards professional development, business owners, staff who wanted to gain computer experience. So the name was originally Computer Training 2000, which got stale dated, of course, quite quickly. I didn't ever intend to start a college.
Wow.
Yeah.
So when you say start a college, that sounds like a pretty big undertaking. Tell us a little about that, how that all came about.
It was really interesting. And I feel like every person that you'll talk to on your podcast probably has the good old days, the glory days. And the glory days at that time was the federal government had money to help businesses computerize. So there were tools in place to help small businesses grow and keep up with the changing world. Then they looked at the fact that people who were applying for these jobs now were getting left out because they didn't have computer skills. So the government came to me and said, Pauline, would you rework this to train people who are not yet working? So train them to be prepared to fill these new positions. So they paid for me to develop the curriculum and bought all the seats I had to offer to launch training for unemployed individuals. And 35 years later, or 34 years later, that is our complete focus. We're still grounded very much in that training for a purpose that started us, right? Those employers came because they needed to do things differently. The training was very much focused on what they needed to do the next day. How can they get the skills to be effective in their workplace? So with people who are coming in for training to enhance your resume for whatever job it may be, we want to keep it as practical and relevant as we possibly can to help them succeed.
So has there been one single biggest challenge that you've had to face and conquer, and you've done so?
There's been many. It's, you know, if I look backwards, if I look in the rearview mirror, it's been really one challenge after another, and that's business. The first challenge, of course, was getting accredited. That was a long and arduous process. Next followed suit was being registered for BC and Canada student loans. Couple decades later, becoming EQA certified, which stands for Education Quality Assurance. All of it. Being a young woman in the late 80s, early 90s, starting out, had a lot of challenges. And I think traveling that road puts me in a position today to have great stories to tell. And I'm having a, I love the fact that I get to sit at tables and talk about how we've progressed and where we are today and how we got here. So yeah, lots of challenges, but I sit here today, Peter, with gratitude and positivity, and it's been a great, great journey all of these years. And I sold the college 1.5 years ago and retained my position for a 3-year term as president. So, oh. Yeah.
So talk about coming full circle.
Well, in fact, I could never in my wildest dreams have considered how full circle it could be. The new owner is also a young woman, and in fact, a young woman of diversity. So my heart is so full. So it's like my dream came true and I didn't even know that I should be dreaming it.
Hmm.
It's amazing.
Was there ever a moment when you felt in your many years of building this enterprise, what was the moment when you said, aha, we've now got it. I've got it. We can build on this.
That has come and gone so many times, right? You think you got it. You build to that, and then there's the next thing that you're going for. I would say, to be perfectly honest, it was when I had to step away from the business and test those terms that we like to throw around called empowerment. And I was in the position where I needed to let my team go ahead, and I needed to take a step away for health reasons, and the business flourished. My team grew. I couldn't have been more proud of what people chose to do for and with me. It was absolutely amazing. That is one of those moments in your life that you hope it works out, but it surpasses your every expectation. So that would be it.
Would you do it again?
Start a business again?
Yeah. This particular business.
No.
Hmm.
I wouldn't. And the climate has changed tremendously. It's very difficult to start a school nowadays. The regulation is hard to come in as a new entity. It was hard enough to grow with it, but to be in a position to start from scratch, I would have no desire to do that.
Oh, it's interesting.
Mm-hmm.
So what are your future plans then?
Well, being that I'm the founder, of course, my heart will always be with the college. So in retirement, I love the people that I work with, right? They're family. So I know I'll always have a connection. But I'm a serial entrepreneur. So I've got ideas and things that I want to do. I'm also the regional ambassador for the Women's Enterprise Center called WeBC. It used to be the Women's Enterprise Center of BC. It's now rebranded as WeBC. I love my role with WeBC. I'm going to continue that as long as they will have me. It's a passion for me. I've got a lot of irons in the fire of things I want to do and a lot of things I don't want to do.
So what inspires you?
Wow, that is such a great question. I'm inspired by human growth. Being that's the industry I'm in, is personal and professional development. The human engagement is everything to me. I tell people it's like I have lenses, and often through those lenses, I see the elevated version of the student or the team member that I'm working with. And it gives me shivers. I want to be part of that transition or that process that the person is on, be part of their journey. I'm passionate about that. And I love it. I just feel like it's part of who I am. When I get to work with women leaders or women in business, I feel that I'm giving back. I was given so many opportunities when I was young, and I was mentored before I knew really what the word mentor meant, by people who didn't have anything to gain. And I was given the opportunity to really have a life that I didn't see. They had an elevated vision of who I could be and what I was capable of. And so to be in the position to give back in that way means a lot to me. I'm very inspired by that.
So from your perspective, what kind of support do women in business need today?
Certainly all the same supports as men do, but when we put on a female gendered lens, there are some things that can dim the light of leadership on women. One of them is just the taking up of space. And what I mean by that is, women often, this is a broad brushstroke, so I hope I don't get any hate mail, but women often use a diminishing language. We'll say things like, oh, I just have a little thought about that, or I don't know if this makes sense to you, but I'd like to try it out. Where that comes from a place of taking up less space. And if we think just about the words as parents we use, girls' voices tend to be very shrill. So I've heard myself use the words like, oh, can you just keep it a bit more quiet? Can you just turn down the volume a little bit? So all of these things help keep us a little bit less prepared to be in that leadership position. You've heard the phrase, imposter syndrome, where super successful women are still hearing the voices of why they can't. And they're struggling with that on a regular basis. So when we know that this is true, then the supports can be directed to help them grow into those and overcome those challenges. And one of the programs that I just love is called Taking the Stage. And Peter, hearing your presentation about the public speaking program that you're doing, you would love this program. It's all about communication and communicating in a way that allows us to be comfortable in that leadership light. So, and it's geared towards women. It's fantastic. A program by the Humphrey Group. We know that, again, broad brushstroke, women are more debt adverse. So when funding or financing is required to move their business forward, there's a stress around that typically. We know that there's the double bind of family and business, more so than the male counterparts in most cases. We saw that more women had to leave the workforce during the pandemic to care for their children and to provide that homeschooling that was required when all schools shut down. I had a fabulous dinner with my eldest stepdaughter yesterday, and she is a contemporary, brave woman in business and has a 2-year-old. So, you know, it's still very true today that the pull is really difficult. You know, it's being pulled at both ends. So those things are all still true. We see way more women in management and leadership roles. But in, I think it's 30% in big business, in larger organizations that are women. So there's a lot of room for growth there. Does that answer your question?
It does. As I was listening to you explaining this, the question is not about what you said, but do you actually speak to women? Are you on the platform sharing your dreams and your skills and your abilities? Because if you're not, you should be.
Thank you, Peter. Whenever I'm asked, I show up. A friend of mine used the term, she referred to me like a lighthouse. I'm not out seeking boats to save, but I'm there whenever they need me. Mm. So I have individual calls with women all the time through my WBC, with my WBC hat on. I present in group settings whenever I can. I love that. I think you can probably see, like, it's not something that I do because I have to. I absolutely love it.
You can tell it in the way you answer the questions, how thoughtful you are, and you can tell by the pitch of your voice that this is really coming from your heart. You really believe this and you value this and you want to share this with as many people as you can. And it's quite obvious.
I'm speaking at an organization called the eWomen Network coming up. And the title I chose was From Shoulder Pads to Authenticity.
Lovely.
So that's going to be really fun.
Where is that?
It's in Victoria. And I'm just introduced to this organization. So I'm going in a bit cold, and we'll get to know them.
Well, not to embarrass you, but how do you get tickets to this?
I don't know, but Peter, I will make sure that I ask Carmel to send you an invitation.
Okay, terrific. So what are your aspirations?
World peace, And I'm not actually joking here. I was inspired in my late 20s by the Right Honorable Iona Caponola, our former Lieutenant Governor.
Yes.
Who said, for us to be on the right path to world peace, we need to increase women in leadership and decision-making positions globally. So if I can help more women be in that leadership light, that's my job. Iona told me that's my job. I accepted the term in my early 20s or late 20s, and here I am.
And if Iona tells you that, that's what you do.
That is exactly it.
I agree with that. Thank you so much for this time. I appreciate it. I appreciate your enthusiasm and how well you speak and explain the situation of what you're doing. It's wonderful. Thank you so very much.
Oh, it's been such a pleasure being on your podcast, Peter, and I look forward to joining your public speaking workshops. That's going to be exciting.
Well, I hope to learn some things from you, too.
Wonderful.
Okay. Thank you very much.
My pleasure. Have a great day.
Okay. Bye-bye.